In regards to the NBA today, fans and analysts alike seem to be more anxious than ever to determine players as either busts or successful players. The concept of patience with young players is lost on many in the NBA community, which is problematic for a number of reasons. Young players more often than not struggle early in their careers because they're making the jump from playing either college basketball or overseas to the NBA, which is a huge step up in terms of competition and talent. Sure, there are examples of players that excel from the jump, such as Donovan Mitchell, Jason Tatum, and Ben Simmons just last year, and that's fantastic for them. But the truth remains that most other young players take time to develop. This brings us to the topic of today's video, where I will be discussing a player that was written off by many after a few seasons struggling early on, but now looks primed to carve out a big role on an NBA team, and that player is Trey Burke of the New York Knicks. Before I start though, make sure to subscribe to the channel below, as all support is very much appreciated. Now with that being said, let's begin. To start from the very beginning, let's go all the way back to Trey Burke's high school days. He attended Northland High School in Columbus, Ohio, and played alongside Ohio State star and former NBA player Jared Sullinger. Sullinger's dad was the coach of the team, and together they formed quite a formidable duo. His freshman year, he made the team, but didn't play much, but going into his sophomore year, he quickly earned a big role on the team. Northland won the state championship in Ohio that year, and the momentum off of that season earned Burke his first major offer from Penn State. He verbally committed to the Penn State program as a sophomore, but later decommitted as he continued to improve as a player and saw that he could garner better offers. By the end of his high school career, he racked up quite a few awards, including being named Mr. Ohio Basketball in 2011 as a senior. He was a fringe top 100 recruit going into college and was not seen by any publication as a top 10 point guard in his class. This gave him a chip on his shoulder that stuck with him going into the college season at the University of Michigan, which is where he wound up committing to. Now transitioning into his college career, it started pretty well. To be honest, it started a lot better than most probably would have imagined it. Burke and his teammate and future NBA player, Tim Hardaway Jr., formed one of the best backcourts in the country right away. The Wolverines finished with a 24-9 record in the regular season going into March Madness during Burke's freshman year, where they earned a 4 seed in the tournament, and Burke led the team in scoring as a freshman by scoring about 15 points per game. Unfortunately, they got upset in the first round by a 13-seed Ohio, but that just motivated him to come back even stronger the next year, which is exactly what he did. His sophomore season was absolutely phenomenal, and Burke individually improved a lot as a player. He once again led Michigan in scoring with 18.6 points per game, but he also added 6.7 assists per game, 1.6 steals per game, and he shot efficiently from both the field and from three, shooting 46.3% and 38.4% respectively. This production on a team that once again earned a 4 seed in March Madness garnered enough momentum for Burke to be named the National Player of the Year in college basketball in 2013. His Michigan team made it all the way to the championship game this year as well, but lost in heartbreaking fashion to Louisville. After this great year, Burke declared for the NBA draft, as his draft stock was most likely not going to get any higher than it already was. His Player of the Year season gave NBA scouts confidence that he could become a successful NBA player, and Burke wound up getting drafted 9th overall by the Timberwolves, but was traded to the Jazz immediately on draft night, thus beginning his NBA career in Utah. In the NBA, the part of his game that was supposed to translate the most was his ability to be a playmaker and create shots off the dribble. That was what made him so deadly in college, and the Jazz were hoping for something similar at the next level. In his pre-draft scouting report, he was labeled as possibly the most well-rounded offensive player in the entire draft, being compared to Chris Paul not only because of his skill set, but also because of his size and athleticism. Burke could shoot the ball from deep, make tough shots, get into the lane and score off the bounce, and control the tempo and create for his teammates. While Chris Paul became an elite player on both ends of the floor despite being undersized and not the best of athletes, Trey Burke struggled because of those same deficiencies. At only 6'1" and 190 pounds, Burke is definitely on the smaller side of NBA guards. Because he was drafted so high, though, the Jazz gave him every chance imaginable to succeed. They made him the starting point guard as a rookie, and he started 68 out of the 70 games he played that season. His numbers for a rookie weren't all bad, but they were disappointing. He averaged 12.8 points, 5.7 assists, and 3 rebounds per game, which isn't that bad until you look at his efficiency. He only shot 38% from the field and 33% from 3, which is pretty bad. Also, his defense was very poor, and the Jazz as a team were trying to build their identity on the defensive end, so he was bringing them down. No matter though, because some of the most common areas that rookies struggle in is efficiency and defense, so going into his next year, the hope was that he would shake it off and take a step forward. That, however, was not the case, and the exact opposite went down. In his second year, his field goal percentage and three-point percentage declined from a year ago, and they were already subpar originally, so now things began to get worrisome. In his third season, he completely lost his starting job, and despite improving slightly shooting the ball, it was nowhere near league average, and at that point, the Jazz gave up on him. For his fourth season, he was signed by the Washington Wizards with the hope that he could get his career back on track in a new location while also learning behind John Wall, who was one of the best point guards in the league. But as has been a trend throughout Burke's career up to this point, he was once again a disappointment, and the Wizards wound up signing Brandon Jennings in the middle of the season to take Burke's backup spot, pushing him completely out of the rotation. Now that we've caught up on the reasons why Burke has been labeled as a bust by many throughout his career, we can finally begin discussing why I have not yet given up on him, and why I still believe he has a bright future ahead of him in the NBA. To start with some off-the-court stuff, Burke got married before the season started last year, and he has said himself that that helped settle himself down and humble himself. He has acknowledged in interviews that his focus and mindset wasn't always in the right things, and he has had unnecessary distractions from partying to enjoying himself too much as a professional. Now he doesn't have to worry about that, because his wife is waiting for him at home and he's raising 2 children with her. That helped him clear his mind going into last season, and while he wasn't given any big opportunities anywhere, he took full advantage of whatever he got. He was invited to the New York Knicks training camp, but was told that it would be certain that he would spend a majority of the time in the G League. He used that time to get his confidence back and continue to improve his game, and kept a positive attitude through it all. When in the G League, he proved that he was way too talented to even be there in the first place. He was torching defenses, putting up monster numbers on a nightly basis, and racking up awards along the way. He set the Knicks' G League record for scoring in a game, won Performer of the Week numerous times, and won Player of the Month in the G League in December. As this was happening, the Knicks' NBA team was taking notice, and in January they signed him to the team. Along with his new confidence and improved play, he also began to sport a new look with cornrows, resembling Sixers legend Allen Iverson. The funniest part of that is that his game, to a degree, began to remind people of Iverson as well. He began to utilize more crossovers, hesitations, and stepbacks on offense, leading to pull-up jumpers in an Iverson-like fashion. Along with that, he was also playing a lot smarter, taking more quality shots and not forcing as much. The Knicks started by working him into the rotation slowly, giving him a few minutes each game at the beginning, but he was playing so well that they had to continually increase his minutes as the season continued on. By the end of the season, Burke even earned the starting point guard job and started the final 9 games of the season. The pinnacle of his season and the official mark that he was back on track in the league came against the Charlotte Hornets on March 26th. In this game, he scored 42 points, which is no small feat, and he even had 12 assists in the game as well, showing off a new and improved all-around game capable of creating points not only for himself, but for others at a high level as well. He finished the year averaging 12.8 points and 4.7 assists per game, which you might recognize as being similar to his rookie year numbers, but he accomplished this in about 10 fewer minutes per game, and the biggest improvement was his efficiency, that he once struggled with. He shot a tremendous 50.3% from the field, and a league average 36.2% from three. The fact that he is back to scoring the ball well, which is what he was drafted to do in the first place, is the biggest reason why I am confident in his future. Going into this season, he is the favorite to win the starting job of the New York Knicks, and with Kristaps Porzingis out for at least half of the season, he should be in for a career year with high usage. He's even become a leader on the Knicks team, taking young point guard Frank Ntilikina under his wing. He's been taking Frank to work out with him in early mornings to build upon the already good chemistry that the two had last year. Overall, though, Burke's newfound maturity, confidence, and improved game has given his career new life, and moving forward, he can be a very good contributor on a team. Realistically, he would make for a very good sixth man on a contender that can provide a spark off the bench and dominate second units. He will be a free agent in the summer of 2019 again, and by that time, he might find himself receiving some big money offers being thrown at him. And with that being said, that's all I have for you today. Make sure to like the video, subscribe to the channel, and follow me on Twitter at hoopsreference. Stay tuned for more videos coming very soon every week, and on that note, I'll see you next video.